Thank you. Thanks, Professor Molnar, for this invitation. Thanks to the St. John College, to Pietro Corsi, to the FENS. I'm very happy to speak here in Oxford, which is has been a center for history of neuroscience, for me particularly for the presence many years ago of Charles Scott Sherrington and many others along the centuries. I'm very pleased to speak about Galileo. And there is a connection with Oxford because last year, in the occasion of 450 years after Galileo's birth, we published a book with Nick Wade with Oxford University Press concerning, let's say, Galileo as a physiologist of sense. This is a particular view of Galileo, but is not is relatively important, as I will try to show. So Galileo could produce a great step forward in the history of science, in particular in history in cosmology, not only because he had new techniques to observe the sky, but because he had also mental technique, new mental technique, in part because he had a new physics of motion. He applied the physics of motion to the interpretation of sky events, but also he had a new methodology in interpreting the sense, and particularly visual image. I am in some way happy that I'm speaking not after Colin Blackmore, because what I'm saying now is very well known to people like Colin. Perhaps was not so important to present, but perhaps now is more novel in some way. Please look at this image and tell me what you see here. A gray square, I would say. Now, there is no change here, there will be no change here, but just around. And now it seems to me that the square is not, is a brilliant, is a, let's say, white square. There is a real change in the appearance. Galileo was perfectly aware that the appearance of a visual pattern depends in a strong way from not only from the physical irradiance of the object, but also from the surround, and he used this this knowledge in interpreting the visual image, particularly the telescopic image. This is another small. Do you see that there was a difference before or not? And if I cover the border, no difference. In the computer, it's very strong. I don't know if it is strong here. Okay. So this is another instance in which a difference, a small difference in a part of a pattern changed the vision around. And is a contrast effect. This is Korsvitz illusion. And Galileo was aware of phenomena like that in interpreting the image of the sky. And now let's go to Galileo. So one of the first instances in which Galileo showed his capability of interpreting visual image was during a controversy with a German Jesuit, Christoph Scheiner. The controversy concerned the sunspot. It concerned several aspects of sunspot. Sunspots were considered something impossible to reconcile with the old cosmology, with the classic cosmology, which pretended that the sun was a perfect body and there could be no alteration of its phase, no change. It was perfect and immutable. Galileo showed that there was this spot, the spots were changing, so the sun were not immutable. And the controversy was very harsh. But what I want to now consider a particular aspect of this controversy. Scheiner said that according to him, to present the presence of this spot on the face of the sun was something that he considered inconvenient, something that was never be probable. Galileo showed that the spot were there, but Scheiner said that this spot, this were very dark, according to him, much more dark than the spot that we see on the moon. But Galileo said, this is not true. I will show that these dark spots are very bright, much more bright, not only of the dark part of the moon, but even of the brilliant part of the moon, which seems a paradox. And he showed that. So Galileo knew well that you cannot compare two visual objects unless you are in the same condition. So you should observe the spot on the sun and the moon in the same condition of observation against the same background. But is it impossible to observe the sun and the moon in the same background? Because when the moon moves toward the sun, it becomes, for astronomical reason, new moon, so it cannot be seen. So Galileo made a thought experiment, a Gedanken experiment, and he considered Venus, which is the most brilliant celestial body, more brilliant than the moon. When Venus arrives near the sun, it cannot be seen because it is much less brilliant than the area surrounding the sun. Therefore, according to the Galileo thought experiment, the moon, which is less brilliant than Venus, will not be seen if it is where near the sun, that is in the brilliant field surrounding the sun. But when we look at the sun with the telescope, the bright field around the sun appear dark, and the sunspots are much more brilliant than that. The conclusion of Galileo is that, therefore, the sunspots are more brilliant, not only of the dark part of the moon, but even of the bright part of the moon. Even thus they appear, if they appear dark. And what we can have visualize the situation with this image. This is an image with a sunspot. In order to see the sunspot, you have to put very dark filter, so you see the sun, you see the spot, but the spots are less dark than the area around the sun. But if this area is not dark, is dark compared to the sun and compared to the sunspot, but is very brilliant. If you want to look at it, you must, of course, cover the sun, and you will see that this is a very brilliant area. And when Venus comes here, you cannot see it, so you cannot see the moon. So, during this controversy, another aspect that arose concerned the brilliancy of the moon. According to the old cosmology, all the celestial bodies from the moon outside were perfect, were made by a very particular substance, the quintessenza or ether, and they were perfect, perfectly polished. And this was for this the reason that they shone in the sky when illuminated by the sun. Galileo, and since the Earth is not so perfect, is not made by ether, for the old cosmology, the Earth could not shine when looked from outside, let's say. Galileo showed, make a long reasoning, showing that the moon and the other planets shine in the sky, not because they are perfectly polished, they are made by kind of a diamond, but just because they are imperfect, their surface is rough, and if their surface would be perfect, like a mirror, we could not see them. This is a paradox, but is a reason why we see the moon brilliant. The moon is brilliant because it's imperfect, like the Earth, and so also the Earth will be seen shining in the sky if somebody could observe it from outside, from another planet, so let's say. And the reasoning is in the same text of the controversy with the, with Shiner, and Galileo insisted that the fact that we see the moon brilliant is just because we can observe it illuminated by the sun against the dark sky of the night. But if we observe the moon during the day, the moon is not more brilliant than a cloud and a terrestrial object. It becomes very brilliant just because of a contrast effect. That is just because of that. So Galileo, this capability of Galileo of interpreting the image, which depends in large measure from his artistical education. Galileo had studied drawing, painting. He was a painter, expert of painting, and also, a critic of painting, which helped him interpreting this image. Here is a painting, a watercolor of Galileo, which was used for preparing the illustration of the Sidereus Nuncius. I cannot read all the description of this watercolor, but the description is just a text of visual physiology. Even the painting, you see, this concerns the fact that also the dark part of the moon has some visibility. There is a small brightness, a dark light, let's say. But Galileo paint the moon more brilliant when it is against the darkness of the sky, and more dark when it's near the bright field of the moon. And Galileo explained in a full way the reason of this dark light in the dark part of the moon. He said, "I have shown that the Earth can shine because of the mechanism of reflection by the moon, from the moon, from the other planets, and also from the Earth, is a diffuse reflection, the reflection typical of a rough body. So if the Earth shine, it will illuminate the moon. So this is the light reflected from the Earth to the moon. As we can, in a night of full moon, we can walk in a forest illuminated by the light of the moon, so in the same way, and even better, the inhabitants of the moon, if they existed, could walk on the moon because the Earth is shining on them. Galileo knew well, much before Armstrong had the mission Apollo went to the moon, that the Earth was shining against the dark sky of the night. Is clear up until here? Now, Galileo and not only could interpret the image in a very perceptive way because of his scientific and artistic education, but Galileo was aware, as are aware all visual physiologists, in that case, I've been glad that Colin spoke before me, that vision is not simply a photography of the reality, taking a neural photography of reality. Vision is a very complex process, extracting information from the image, from the physical image, from the optical image on the retina, and from neural image. And we should not say that something is that because we see it like this. We see is interpreting. There is a text, this is not a controversy, but concern is also a controversy in part, concern a relation with a Jesuit, in which Galileo display his awareness of the complexity of the visual process. So the Jesuit, a group of Jesuits in Mantua, had accepted at the beginning conclusion of Galileo concerning the presence of mountains on the moon. But they wanted to accept just the presence of mountain in the main part of the moon, because they said we can see the mountains, protuberance, on the moon face that look to the Earth, so the main part. So we can. There is reason to affirm that they are there. But the problem concerns the fact that Galileo pretended to say that mountains were also on the external circumference of the moon. But the telescope did not show any protuberance there. So Jesuit said, so there are no protuberance there. There are no mountains there. Galileo, in responding to those, this objection, said, the father, the Jesuit, writes, there are in apparent luna fascia, there are luna fascia which look to the Earth protuberance. I answer, not. They don't appear. And I say that protuberance and eminence of the moon as eminence not only cannot be seen from such a long distance, but that they could not even be seen from a close, from as close as 100 miles, similar to our hills and to the major mountains, which by no means would be discerned to arise above the flat region from an altitude and distance of 50 miles. Galileo said that when we see something, we say this is a mountain, is not because we see the mountain, but our visual process, our visual experience, a series of visual experiment which we do, bring us to the conclusion this is a mountain. But we cannot say this amount is a mountain because we see it. I walk very often on the mountains. These are the mountains where I go at least once a week or twice a week. One day with Nick Wade, the co-author of the book on Galileo, we made 40 kilometers on this mountain. So, but I know any part of this mountain. But if you ask me, is this a mountain or a valley or a forest, I could not say. Because I could say that only if you take the image in different moment of the day, I know the origin of the obliquity of the sun, and so on. So, visual process is not an immediate representation of the reality. And Galileo was completely aware of that. How many minutes I have? Okay. Now I pass to another aspect of a Galileo consideration of the sense. Galileo not only was able to understand better than other the visual image, especially the telescopic image. In telescopic image are very far, so we have not the immediate possibility to verify with touch or with other sense what we should really critically understand that. But also was aware of the was modern in considering the sense in another important, very important way, I will say philosophical way. He expounded his consideration in the Saggiatore, one of his main work. So in the Saggiatore he said, when I look to something, I consider it some property of the object, for instance, motion, form, dimension, position in the space, are real attributes of the object. But when somebody said, you can read this play, when somebody tells to me that an object has a particular color, produce a particular odor, produce a particular sound, and he pretend that these are attributes of the object, I say, no, there are not these sound, color, taste, odor, are not intrinsic attribute of the object. They exist because there is a body capable of perceiving them. If there were not such body, there were not such attribute. And this seems not particularly modern, but he made an example. He say, suppose that we move a hand and we touch this a statue, and for instance the armpit of a statue, we say that the hand is moving when it touch the armpit of the feet of a statue. We say that simply the hand is moving, but if it touch a man or woman, we have another. We say that there is produced a tickling, but the fact that there is a man or woman who perceive a tickling is a justification to say that the hand has an attribute which is tickling. No, it's movement. So sensation are the effect on interaction with a sensitive body, a sensitive individual, and a stressed body, which is also important from a philosophical point of view. But what means this? For Aristotle, the world were provided with sensible, that is, with attributes which were part of reality, and which were color, odor, taste, and so on, which were message that the world, the object, sent to the individual. So not only in the Aristotelian world were a teleology, a finalism toward human in a cosmological sense, in a finalistic sense, but also in a sensory sense. For Galileo, the world is not sending any message to humans. Human can understand the world, but in the world there are movement. Now we could say there are oscillation on the electromagnetic oscillation. There are chemical particle responsible for taste or for odor. There are vibration, but there is nothing as sound sound, call, and so on. Galileo was too modern for his time, and what he said re-entered in the history of culture, especially with Kant and with his physiologist follower. For instance, in the book by Kandel, and Manual of Kandel, we can read in the chapter considering the sense. A statement like this: color, tone, smell, and tastes are mental creations constructed by the brain out of the sensory experience. They do not exist as such outside the brain. Thus, we can now answer to the old riddle. Does a felling tree make a sound if no one is near enough to hear it? Sound, as we know it, occurs only when pressure waves from a felling tree are perceived by the brain of a living being. So, and if you consider the color, for instance, if we consider the fact that a man, a woman, perceive exactly the same sensation, for instance, yellow, either with a light of 600, about 600 nanometers, or with a combination of two light, one 630 and 550, exactly the same sensation. Considering that, you can say that yellow exists in nature. No, you can say that those electromagnetic oscillation exists in nature. And color exists only with reference also to a sensitive body. I finish now my... So Galileo displaced human, not only from their position, the center, cosmological centrality at the center of the universe, but also that from the centrality in at the center of an universe in which nature was finalized and also spoke to humans. So I conclude with this prize of Galileo Assai. Okay, so you read in English, I read in Italian. Il più nobile occhio che abbia mai fabbricato la natura. Io dico l'occhio del signor Galileo Galilei, primo filosofo del Serenissimo Granduca di Toscana. Occhio tanto privilegiato e di tante altre prerogative dotato che si può dire con verità che gli abbia visto più egli solo che tutti gli occhi insieme degli uomini passati e abbia aperto quelle dei futuri, essendo toccato in gran parte a lui solo fare tutti gli scoprimenti celesti ammiranti ai secoli futuri nella Via Lattea, nelle stelle nebulose, nei pianeti medici, in Saturno, in Giove, in Marte, in Venere, nella Luna e nel Sole stesso. E però è degno d'essere eternamente conservato come una preziosa gemma, e tanto più quando egli è stato ministro di quel suo meraviglioso intelletto, eccitando a filosofare così altamente delle cose, onde egli ha trapassato tutti gli ingegni umani, i quali fin qui si sono intrigati a penetrare i più reconditi segreti della natura, perdita veramente preziosissima e deplorata con lacrime universale di tutti gli occhi umani, in particolare dei legittimi investigatori della verità. Thank you.